Jane McGonigal.
Good morning. This is going to be super fun today. I was so excited about coming out here today to do this keynote that I actually have to confess I couldn't wait until now to start. I actually started this keynote 4 days ago. That was on Friday. I started tweeting my keynote. And I asked people to answer the question, what do you think games can change? Because, you know, ever since this organization started, I love the name, but it makes me want to get kind of geeky about the terminology and be like, games for change. We're in favor of change. We want to make change. But what exactly are we trying to change? And I got a lot of responses that I wanted to actually share the stage with all the people thinking about games for change and share with you the responses I heard. More than 500 people wrote back to tell me what they think games can change. And it's interesting. I started out with this question. Which is, what can games change? By the way, I'm playing a game backstage with my friend. Go back. Can you go back? One. Does that work? Great. Thanks. I'm not actually controlling my slides. We're sort of mentally telecommunicating with this clicker. Our game is to try to sync up for the first time. See how well we do with that. What can games change? And a lot of people respond to that question thinking about what we hope to change in the world. Games can change education. Games can change healthcare. Games can change government. All things that we want to change. And I realized that maybe there was a second question on top of that, which is not what out in the world are we trying to change, but what is it that games always change? That every game, not just social impact games, but every game we play, what do games, through the process of gameplay, fundamentally change? So then I started thinking about that as a second question. What are games changing whenever we play them? And can we use that sort of intrinsic, natural, transformative property of every game on that 100 list of games you should play, every single one of those games is changing something. And can we use that intrinsic nature of change to do this sort of social impact change? And if we can figure out what games naturally change, what I really want to get geeky about today is this question, which is, how do we measure the change? Because I think the Games for Change community, myself included, we have done a good job over the last, say, 5 years, convincing people that games can change the world, the idea that it's possible and that we should dedicate ourselves to it. But we need to now move forward to showing exactly where that change happens, when it happens, how much it happens. There's a great old saying that I'm sure everybody knows, you can't improve something unless you can measure it. And we have the opportunity to start measuring the change that our games make in really new and exciting ways. So we're gonna get a little geeky today about measurements. But first I wanna just share with you what these 500 plus people think about, what games do change, what all games change. And by the way, I apologize, this is like going to be impossible to read. I just made this up over the weekend because you guys were all tweeting at me, so I'm sorry they're not more gorgeous. But this idea that games can change moods, everybody was talking about that. You know, after a hard day at work, we happily play together and learn that a better world is possible. Games can change my bad mood and the way I feel in a matter of minutes and cure my headache after a busy day. Games can change my outlook on my day. Games can change negative into positive thoughts. Games can change my negativity into positivity after a frustrating day at the office. Games can change the world, making people happier so they can do better. And if I had to really sum up all the tweets that I'm seeing about this, you know, I would think about this as a kind of emotional resilience. A lot of people talk about how when we sit down in front and play games, that our mood can be transformed. We can bounce back from a negative mood or negative thinking into a more positive emotional state. So let's keep that in mind, and we're going to talk about how maybe we can measure the changes in that positive emotional state. So another cluster of tweets that I saw were like this. Games can change our willingness to take risks, try new things. They are safe places to experiment, gain confidence. Games can change long-term, short-term preferences, outlooks, risk aversion, willingness to trust. Games can change paralyzing fear of failure into determination to at least reach the next level. Games can make failure friendlier and the daunting doable. And when I think about all these tweets, it really seems to me like a kind of mental resilience. this ability to stay determined and focused and optimistic and have grit and perseverance and not give up and not be afraid of failure. And the idea of mental change can actually be taken to another level. We're going to talk about how we might measure increased mental resilience. But then there's a whole other kind of crazy idea that everybody was tweeting about. And really, I wanted to see if we could measure this. Games can change your mind. Games can change how our brains are wired, change cognitive pathways via play. Games can change my brain through neuroplasticity, change your brain mass, change the structure of your brain. A lot of people in our community think that this is possible. Are we going to be able to measure that? Are we going to be able to show that? We're going to talk about that today. Another cluster was about relationships, of course, multiplayer, social gaming. Games can change relationships. Games can change friendships. Games can change my social confidence, my ability to interact with others. Games can change relationships. I have deep, solid relationships with people I play with. Change family relationships for the better. Change how you relate to your daughter and her friends. They can even change your teamwork. And you can think about this as a kind of social resilience, that it's building up our ability to have stronger relationships with the people around us. So we're going to talk about how we might measure that. And then there was a sort of other category that came up again and again, having to do with self-image. Games can change your sense of self. I'm not just a boring old person. I'm a rock band drummer, rock on. Games can change the way we see ourselves, change linear self-confidence, change our perception of what we're capable of, change a player's understanding of his or her own human potential, change the way one thinks about goals, and thus what one thinks they can achieve. And then I look at all those tweets, it sounds to me like what we're really talking about is self-efficacy, this idea that we have the power to impact the outcome of events, that there are actions we can take, and that will transform the future, our own future, our own lives. So we're going to talk about how we might be able to prove and measure changes in self-efficacy. And then this one we all know about. This is one that is sort of, I think, the premise underlying everything. Games can just change how excited you are about something. They can change dull and boring into fun and interesting. They can change the level of student engagement in a classroom tremendously. They can change level of engagement across the board, turning apathy into action. They're about taking charge, making decisions. And we know if there's one thing that games do change, it's engagement. It changes disinterest into interest. It turns boredom into wholehearted participation. And so we definitely think about engagement as being something that we'll want to measure. We'll want to, how do we measure that engagement and what that engagement leads to? So that's what this keynote is about. How do games change? What do games change and how can we measure it? Emotionally, mentally, neurologically, socially, how they change self-efficacy and engagement. And I have tried to do my best to marshal the science to reflect back to you what you and all the people on Twitter are feeling sort of intuitively, that games are capable of changing all of those things. I want us to be able to not just, you know, intuit that that is happening, but to be able to show people the science that this is really happening. So I want you to relax and enjoy this keynote, not to take any notes or anything. So I've actually put up a webpage, showmethescience.com, and I put all the research that I'm going to show you in this talk. I think there are about 100 peer-reviewed papers that we're going to be flying around and looking at, and you can access the papers fully. They're not behind firewalls. You can read the whole thing and all the citations and actually dig in yourself so that you can figure out, you know, how you might want to work with it, what you want to make of it. So just remember, showmethescience.com. I'll remind you at the end too. And then just, you know, sort of relax, and we're going to go on a big geeky journey together. Before we do that, I just want to show you one last category of tweets that I got. It really resonated with me about what games can change. Games can change your heart. Games can change what you value in life. Games can change desires. Games can change your outlook on life. Games can change your life. Games can change your life. Games can change your life. Simple. Games can change your life. I believe that. I believe that a lot. And in the past year or so of my life, I've become more and more interested in working on games for change at the personal level, at the individual level, changing lives, boosting that emotional, social, neurological, mental resilience, increasing self-efficacy and engagement for the person to be more engaged wholeheartedly with their own lives so that we can then use that to change the whole world. So, you know, be the change that you want to see in the world at the individual level. So maybe that's really what this talk is about. That games can change lives and we can measure that change. We don't normally think about you know, changing someone's life as a kind of a scientific geeky thing that we can measure. But now we can. The research is moving in that direction. So that's what we're going to talk about. Now, I did want to share with you a little secret about this talk. I'm a gamer. This is my proof that I'm a gamer. I do play more recent games than this, but if you ever come to San Francisco, there's this great arcade of classic arcades all the way back to the, like, 1900, like, the original arcades called Musée Mécanique. So come play geeky games with us from 100 years ago in San Francisco. Now, the thing about me being a gamer is that I do like to have goals, right? I like sort of secret missions and objectives. So I have a secret mission for this talk. I'm already working on it, in fact. And my mission is that I'm going to try to increase the lifespan of everyone in this room by 7.5 minutes. Because what do gamers want more than that extra life power up? I'm going to do that. So literally, you will live 7.5 minutes longer than you would have otherwise, just because you watched this talk. But you're looking a little bit skeptical, some of you. That's fine, because I actually have math to prove that this is possible. It will not make a lot of sense to you yet. I'm going to explain it at the end. But the most important part is right there at the bottom, the plus 7.6824583.7 more minutes of life. That will be my gift to you if I'm successful in my mission. Now, you have a secret mission, too. Your mission is to decide how you want to spend these extra 7.5 minutes. And I think you should do something really unusual with them, because these are bonus minutes, and we're not going to have them anyway, so please don't spend them doing email or something stupid like that. I'm going to give you some ideas later of how to spend them. And you know me, you probably have a pretty good idea of what I might tell you to do with those 7.5 minutes. You're probably thinking that I'm going to tell you to spend them playing games, which is a totally reasonable assumption, especially given where we are today. And I have made quite a habit of telling people to spend more time playing games, most famously in the TED Talk, when I said that we should aspire to spend 21 billion hours a week as a planet playing games. So 21 billion hours, it does sound like a lot of time. It sounds like so much time, in fact, that I wanted to share with you the number one unsolicited comment that I have heard from people all over the world since I gave that TED Talk in 2010. I hear this all the time. Jane, games are great and all, but on your deathbed, that's what they say, on your deathbed, are you really going to wish you spent more time playing World of Warcraft? Or more recently, I'm getting this version of it, which is on your deathbed. Are you really going to wish you spent more time playing Angry Birds? Now, this idea is so ubiquitous that games are a waste of time that we will later regret. I hear it everywhere I go. This is a true story. Just a few weeks ago, at South by Southwest, on our way to the conference, cab driver, this guy here, finds out that we're there to talk about games, and he turns around and says to us, which is why we got a picture, so I could talk about it, he said, "I hate games, waste of life, imagine getting to the end of your life and regretting all that time." So literally, this is just, everybody says this, and I want to take this problem seriously, because I want games to be a force for good in the world. I don't want people to regret the time they spent playing games. I'm dedicating my whole career to telling people to spend more time playing games. And I want them to be a force for good. So I've been thinking about this question a lot lately. When we are on our deathbeds, will we regret the hours we spent playing games? I take this very seriously. Now, it turns out, this may surprise you, there is actually some scientific research on this question. It's true. You may have seen the headlines earlier this year. Hospice workers, the people who take care of us at the end of our lives, have actually issued a report on what people most frequently express regret about when they are literally on their deathbeds talking to the hospice workers. So that's what I want to share with you today. The actual top five regrets of the dying. So number one, I wish I hadn't worked so hard, top regret. I wish I hadn't worked so hard. I wish I'd stayed in touch with my friends. I wish I had let myself be happier. I wish I'd had the courage to express my true self. I wish I'd live a life true to my dreams instead of what others expected of me. Now, as far as I know, nobody told these hospice workers, "I really wish I'd spent more time playing games." But when I hear these top five regrets, I can't help but hear, and maybe you are hearing the same thing, five deep human cravings that we know that games can actually help us fulfill. For example, I wish I hadn't worked so hard. You know, for many people, this means I wish I spent more time with my family, with my kids, when they were growing up. We know that games are a great way to strengthen family relationships. You may have seen the research from Brigham Young University's School of Family Life last year, showing that parents who frequently play video games with their kids have much stronger relationships with them in real life. I wish I'd stayed in touch with my family and friends. Sorry, that's a bit cut off. Well, we know that hundreds of millions of people use social games like Farmville or Words with Friends or Draw Something every single day to stay in touch with their family and friends. And recently, Michigan State University published research showing that these social games are actually a tremendously powerful relationship management tool. They help us stay actively in touch with people in our extended social network that we would otherwise grow distant from if we weren't playing games together. I wish I'd let myself be happier. Now here I can't help but think of the groundbreaking clinical trials conducted at East Carolina University over the past couple of years, showing that online games actually outperform pharmaceuticals for treating clinical anxiety and depression. That's true. If you haven't seen my research, I really recommend that you look it up. Just 30 minutes of online gameplay a day was enough to significantly boost mood and increase happiness on the long term. So. Very interesting research. I wish I had the courage to express my true self. Well, we know that avatars, of course, can be a way to express our true selves, oftentimes an idealized, heroic version of who we might be at our best. You can see that in this portrait here of a gamer with his avatar taken by Robbie Cooper. Stanford University has been doing research for more than 5 years now, showing how playing a game with an idealized avatar actually changes how we think and act in real life, making us more ambitious, more confident, and more committed to our goals. I wish I'd led a life true to my dreams and not what others expected of me. This one I'm not so sure about, so I've left a question mark here. You know, we think about games as being escapist, not as powering up our real life dreams. So I left a question mark, a little smart question mark for you. We'll come back to that one, I promise. But you know, first, I'm sure you weren't expecting to hear a talk about deathbed regrets when you came to Games for Change, and maybe you're thinking to yourself, you know, who's Jane to talk about deathbed regrets? And it's true, I've never been a hospice worker. I've never been on my deathbed yet, but recently I did spend 3 months in bed actually wanting to die, really wanting to die, and I'm going to tell you that story. It started in the summer of 2009. I hit my head and got a concussion, and the concussion didn't heal properly. So after 30 days, I was left with symptoms like nonstop headaches, nausea, vertigo, memory loss, mental fog. I couldn't work at all. I could barely read or write. At the time, I was trying to express to friends and family what was going on, but it was hard because of the traumatic brain injury. This is something I scribbled down to try to explain. Everything is hard. The iron fist is pushing against my thoughts. My whole brain feels vacuum pressurized. If I can't think, who am I? That was towards the beginning of it, and it was so hard to write that it took me more than an hour, and I just kind of gave up and stopped for a while. Now, in order to get better, my doctor told me that the most important thing to do was to rest my brain, because if I exhausted my brain, it would be able to heal. So there were all these things that I had to avoid because they were triggering symptoms, they were stressing my brain out. And that list for me personally was no reading, no writing, no video games, no work or email, no running, no alcohol, and no caffeine. I think you see where this is going. No reason to say it. Which, of course, is meant to be funny. But in all seriousness, as many of you may know from personal experience or friends and family, suicidal ideation is actually quite common with traumatic brain injuries. It happens to 1 in 3, and it actually happened to me. My brain started telling me, Jane, you want to die. It said, you're never going to get better. I was convinced of that. It said, the pain will never end. And these voices became so persuasive and so persistent that I legitimately started to fear for my life. I was very scared. So at that point, like any good game designer, I did say to myself, I'm either going to kill myself or I'm going to turn this into a game. Now, I know it sounds so stupid in retrospect, but you know, why would you turn something into a game? Well, I knew from 10 years of researching the psychology of games that when we play games, and this is in the scientific literature, we tackle tough challenges with more creativity, with more optimism, with more determination, and we're more likely to reach out to other people for help. And I wanted to bring those gamer traits to my real life challenge, so I invented a role-playing recovery game called Team the Concussion Slayer. That became my new secret identity. The first thing that I did as the Concussion Slayer was call up my twin sister and tell her, I am playing the game to heal my brain, and I want you to play the game with me. This was actually an easier way to ask for help. It was hard to say, it's been 34 days and nothing is better and I'm terrified and help. Much easier to say, I want you to play a game with me. She became my first ally in the game. And my husband joined the game next. We invited some friends. And what we did together was we identified and battled with bad guys. These were anything that could trigger my symptoms and therefore slow down the healing process. I knew I had to just find them and avoid them. So things like bright lights and crowded spaces, and I would escape them before they could do any harm. We also activated and collected power-ups. These were anything that I could do on even my worst days to feel just a little bit happy, just a little bit productive. Things like cuddling my dog for 10 minutes or getting out of bed, getting dressed, and walking around the block just once. So the game was that simple. Adopt a secret identity, recruit your allies, battle the bad guys, activate power-ups. But even with such a simple game, within a few days of starting to play, that black fog of depression and anxiety lifted. It just went away. The headaches and cognitive challenges did not go away. It was not a miracle cure. They lasted for more than a year, definitely the hardest year of my life by far. But even when I still had the pain, even when I still had the symptoms, I stopped suffering so much, which was great. Now, what happened after the game surprised me a little bit. You know, I had made the game in order to get better, as in to get back to normal. But instead of feeling like I was getting just back to normal, just getting better, I felt like I was getting better than I'd been in the first place. I was getting like super better. I was stronger and braver and understood myself better and appreciated my friends and family more. And I felt like I'd basically been to like this trip to the underworld and I survived it. And you know, in mythology, the way that many heroes become heroes is they have to go to the underworld and they have to come back alive. And I felt like I'd made that trip. I'd gone to the worst, most painful place I could imagine. And I'd come back and I mean, you know, I just felt like that I tapped into something in myself. So what I did was I put up a video online sort of explaining how the game worked, how it affected me. Of course, not everybody has a concussion. Not everybody wants to be a slayer. Not a big Buffy the Vampire Slayer fan. Not everybody has their own, you know, storyline to play. So I just, instead of being Jane the Concussion Slayer, renamed the game Super Better. And soon I started to hear from people all over the world who were playing the game for different challenges. They were recruiting their own allies and adopting secret identities and using the game to get super better at things like cancer and chronic pain and losing weight and depression and Crohn's disease and even for terminal diagnoses like ALS. And I could tell from their videos and their messages that the game was helping them in the same ways that it had helped me. They talked about feeling stronger and braver. They talked about feeling better understood by their friends and family. And they even talked about feeling happier, even though they were still in pain, even though they were facing the toughest challenge of their lives. Now, at the time, I was wondering, you know, what's going on here? Is this really possible? I mean, I believe in the power of games for good and games for change, but this is a silly game. It was trivial sounding, and yet, people were using it to face life and death circumstances, and it was intervening in these incredibly powerful ways. And I just couldn't understand how it was possible. So the good news is, there's actually some scientific research here. It turns out that having a traumatic experience can actually make us happier and stronger. And that's what was happening to us. The game was helping us experience what scientists call post-traumatic growth, which is not something we normally talk about. We normally talk about post-traumatic stress disorder. But researchers now know that We're not doomed to suffer indefinitely just because we had a trauma. We can actually use the trauma as a springboard to unleash our best qualities and to actually lead happier lives. So here, for example, are the top five things that people who experience post-traumatic growth say about their experience. They say, my priorities have changed. I'm not afraid to do what makes me happy. I feel closer to my friends and family. I understand myself better. I know who I really am now. I have a new sense of meaning and purpose in my life. I'm better able to focus on my goals and dreams. Now, does this sound familiar? Mm-hmm. A little bit. It should. Because the top five experiences of post-traumatic growth are essentially the exact opposite of the top regrets of the dying. This is interesting, right? It seems like trauma can unlock our ability to lead a life with fewer regrets. But how does it happen? How do you get from trauma to growth? Or better yet, is there any way to get all of these benefits of post-traumatic growth without the trauma, without your head in the first place? I wanted to understand the phenomenon better, and so I devoured the scientific literature, and I learned a few things. The first thing I learned is that there is actually something called post-ecstatic growth. This is a new concept. It's just being studied at University of Pennsylvania, one of the best research centers for positive psychology and resilience research. They call it post-ecstatic growth, and the way you get it is you tackle a challenge that's really hard that you're probably going to fail at, and you can experience the same kind of growth by wholeheartedly trying something that's really hard for you. Anything from running a marathon to becoming a parent for the first time are the kinds of things that can trigger post-ecstatic growth. And it turns out that what you have to do in order to face the challenge successfully, whether it's traumatic or ecstatic, is to build up four types of resilience. And that researchers have actually figured out these scientifically backed ways that you can boost these four types of resilience, and you don't even need the trauma. Now, what I want to do is just show you, just to make sure we're all sort of on the same scientific page. This was just presented last week at Games for Health. This is it's new science. I just want to make sure you guys are on the cutting edge here. So this is what normally, when we talk about normal recovery, we hit a challenge in life, whether it's an injury, illness, something's hard for us, we lose our job, or a challenge that we tackle, and we take a hit, and it takes a long time, and we get back to baseline recovery. If you're resilient, and you're building up these four kinds of strengths that researchers have now identified, you'll take less of a hit, right? And then you'll get right back to baseline. But some people will take a huge hit and go all the way down to rock bottom and then wind up on top way before where they were before. And these four types of resilience, if you build them up, the sort of this middle one, the blue line, is basically ordinary resilience. Most people are born with some resilience. But if you really develop these four strengths to a kind of super level, then you get this post-ecstatic or post-traumatic growth. And I don't want to just tell you what these four strengths are. I actually want you to get some experience with them firsthand right now. I want you to actually start building them up for while we're here together. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to play a little bit of a game together. This is where you're going to earn the 7.5 minutes of extra life that I promised you earlier. We're going to do the first four class of Super Better, which is now a mobile app. It's in the App Store, waiting to be released any day now, and there's actually a preview that you can download and play, which will be the game that we're going to play together. So, here's your first quest. I want you to pick one. Stand up and take 3 steps, or make your hands into fists, raise them over your head as high as you can for 5 seconds. Go! Nice. Somebody doing both. Very ambitious. Overachiever for you. All right, excellent. Well done. All right, now it's Super Better. That's worth +1 physical resilience, which means your body can withstand more stress and heal itself faster. And what we know from the research is that the most important thing you can do every day to build physical resilience is to not sit still. Every single second that you're not sitting still, you're actually actively improving the health of your heart, your lungs, and your brain. So keep not sitting still. Actually, I think you should do this for the rest of the festival. The other speakers won't mind at all. Just figure out how to do this. It'll look like you're cheering for them, so they will just love it. So go ahead and do that. Okay, second quest. Pick one. I want you to snap your fingers exactly 50 times or count backwards from 100 by 7 like this. 193. All the way down to 0. Go. Don't give up. Give all of it down there. You got it? Good. Zero at this one. Good, yeah. And you guys got down to zero? That one takes a little bit longer usually. 16, 9, 2. Good. Okay. So. Good job. Now that's worth plus one mental resilience, which means you have more mental focus, more discipline and determination, and more willpower. And we know from the scientific literature that willpower is actually like a muscle. It gets stronger the more you exercise it. So tackling a tiny quest without giving up all the way to the end, even when it's absurd as snapping your fingers exactly 50 times or counting backwards from 100 by 7, is actually a scientifically backed method to increase your willpower. So, good job. All right, quest number 3. Now this one, because of the rumor and fate, is kind of already determined for us, but here are the 2 official options. We're gonna pick the last one. If you're inside, find a window and look out of it. If you're outside, find a window and look in. I actually like that one a lot. Or do a quick YouTube or Google image search for baby, your favorite animal. Now feel free to do this on your phones or your iPads. If you don't have something, I'm gonna show you some baby animals on the big screen. But what would you look up? What would be some requests here?
Owl.
Nice. Sloth is a good one. I encourage you all to look that one up. We're gonna look, yes, that's my favorite. We're gonna look at a baby dolphin.
Oh.
And a baby llama. Yeah. Okay, everybody feel that? One more. Baby dolphin. Feel that? That's awesome. Okay, well, what we were just feeling there was plus one emotional resilience, which means you have the power to provoke positive emotions when you need them most. So an emotion like curiosity, which you can provoke by just looking out a window or peeking in a window, or love, which we know you can provoke by looking at pictures of baby animals. That's what's happening when we say all. And it turns out that every time you feel an emotional resilience, it actually boosts things like energy, physical stamina, creativity. But the thing that I'm most interested in, it's something called the 3-to-1 ratio. And it turns out that if you can experience 3 positive emotions for every 1 negative emotion or thought over the course of an hour, a day, a week, a month, you're actually dramatically improving your odds of facing any challenge, of solving any problem. And this is called the 3-to-1 ratio. Because we're getting geeky today, I will share with you something I don't usually include, which is that there's actually an upper limit to this ratio. It's 12-to-1. And the reason is if you go above 12-to-1, you lose all the benefits. And the reason why is that other people start to hate you. You seem totally divorced from Addie and you're really annoying to be around. This is literally in the scientific literature. If you go to showmeinscience.com and read the papers on this, they tell you, do not go above 12-to-1, people will hate you and you will not get any benefits. So keep that in mind. Okay, last quest. I want you to pick one. Shake someone's hand for 6 seconds or send someone a quick thank you by text, email, Facebook, or Twitter. Go.
I'm gonna shake hands.
Matt, nice to meet you.
Stand up too much.
It's failure. Social resilience just means that you draw on your neighbors, your community, your friends, your family to make yourself stronger. Gratitude is a really scientifically backed way to boost the social resilience that you have. Touch is even better. Here's another little fun scientific fact that many of you probably know, because I always make my audience members touch each other, so I explain this. If you touch somebody's hand, hold somebody's hand for 6 seconds, this is actually one of the fastest and most reliable ways to boost levels of oxytocin in both of your bloodstreams. Oxytocin is a love hormone, the trust hormone. It makes you want to help people more. So what I wanted to tell you is that this effect will last through lunch. And if there's anybody in the room that you need to ask for a favor, you want to do a little networking, you are now biochemically primed to help each other. Skyhead loves oxytocin. So good job there. Awesome. So congratulations. Since you did the first four Super Better quests, for the next 24 hours, you have increased resilience. So I just wanted to just recommend to you, we're here in New York, do something hard, stay up late, reach out to someone interesting, or take a risk. Because when you have increased resilience, you're more likely to succeed. And if you don't, then you're going to bounce back faster. And maybe you'll even get some of that growth. Now, What I want to do next is kind of go from the sort of sense of boosting our positive emotions and our resilience, and think about if this can actually change people's real life behaviors, actually have measurable impacts that we can take credit for. Because that's what I think Games for Change really needs to do going forward, is actually take credit for the change that we're creating. And this is one of my favorite research projects. The researchers are going to be doing the next session after me, although I've been told they're not talking about this research, so I wanted to make sure that you saw it, because I think it's maybe the single best research to come out of the Games for Change space in the entire history. And it has to do with the neurological activity that happens when we play games. So this is from Hope Lab, working with Stanford researchers. Now, if you know Hope Lab, you know them from their game Remission, which you can see up here. This was a game created for young people with cancer, and it teaches them about how chemotherapy works, and it gives them this really cool, inspiring, empowering experience of blasting the cancer inside a body with chemotherapy weapons. Now, they found some interesting things out from the players who would play this game. They ran randomized controlled studies, so they have very well-validated scientific literature on this. And they found that for people who played the game, even for as few as 2 hours total gameplay, that they had significantly better chemotherapy adherence. Many young people with cancer, they have to take chemotherapy drugs for 3 years, oral chemotherapy, lots of side effects. You can easily forget dosages. But they found that that having high adherence is really important. I think 80% of cases that return come from people who have missed dosages. So there's really something you can do to beat cancer. And they not only found better adherence by asking the players, were they adhering, they actually measured the level of the chemotherapy chemicals in the body and found 20% higher levels in the bloodstream of patients who were playing this game. So to indicate that they actually were, in fact, more engaged with chemotherapy after they played the game. And they found from interviewing the players that they had higher rates of self-efficacy, that if you ask them, can you beat cancer? Is this something you can do today to help you beat cancer? They were more likely to say yes if they had played the game. This is pretty impressive to see that playing a game for as little as a couple of hours could potentially change your behavior for up to 3 years of a chemotherapy regimen. I mean, if that's possible, that's change that can change the world. But Hope Lab and Stanford researchers wanted to figure out why this was happening. I mean, how could you play a game for as little as 2 hours and have it change your behavior for years? It sounds crazy. So they put gamers in fMRI machines to look at the neural activity. Now fMRIs, it's still new. They're not, it's not as easy as reading an X-ray and seeing that a bone is broken. There's still a lot of interpretation. But the preliminary findings are really exciting. Now what they did is they put gamers, and look at the active side here, were people who were playing this remission game in the fMRI machine. You can see all that neural activity. The passive side was not, as you might guess, somebody who was just lying there doing nothing. That's what it looks like. They were actually watching someone else play the game. Well, this is really interesting. If we're used to thinking of, a lot of what's immersive and powerful about games is, the amazing look and sound of it, right? That immersive media quality. But just watching and hearing the game didn't light up the brain hardly at all, compared to the active gameplay, actively playing the game. And when they compared the regions that were lit up, so the composite here showing regions that were strongly lit up during interactive play versus just passively watching the game, two areas of main interest. One are the caudate and the thalamus, which have to do with the reward center of the brain. We know that when these areas are really lit up, that people are highly motivated and they are less likely to give up, that they will stay truly focused on a goal, do whatever it takes to get that goal, and that region of the brain was really lit up. We experience a lot of pleasure when this area of the brain is lit up, right? And it's why things that light up this part of the brain, we sometimes think about them as addicting, because when this area of the brain lights up, we love it. It's a rush, it's a pleasure. Now, what was fascinating about the study was that these areas of the brain were not lighting up when the players succeeded. This was not in response to victory, and I did it, and I'm leveling up, and I'm getting points, and I'm getting a reward, and I'm getting loot. which sometimes I think people think that's what gamers are craving, that sort of, I'm just doing it, so I've got to get to the next level, or I want more loot, I love my virtual goods. That's not what's lighting it up. These regions of the brain were lighting up immediately after the player had taken an action, like aiming and firing, and it was lighting up while we were waiting to see the impact of the effort they had made. So this was in response to the pleasure of pursuing an outcome and hoping that it would make a difference, hoping that it would hit the target, hoping that it would lead to a win. That's what lit up the pleasure centers, that hope, that anticipation that I would see the impact of my action. I think this is the single most important breakthrough in gaming research that I've seen in a decade. Understanding that the pleasure of games is really tied to self-efficacy and agency, that the thrill of gaming is that hope that we can do something that matters. The thrill of gaming is in seeing, I took an action, what will happen next, that curiosity and discovery. Now the other part of the brain that was really lit up was the hippocampus, which is circled in a funny place here, but it's just because of the way the composite is done. And the hippocampus is the area of the brain we associate with long-term memory and learning. Now this is interesting when you combine that with this region of the brain associated with reward and self-efficacy, because it suggests that there is an educational process happening during the game, that they are locking in this experience of agency and self-efficacy, that is not just a fleeting emotion, that it's actually getting committed to long-term memory, that they are learning about themselves, that they are capable. Now, I love this study because you didn't have to do all this fMRI research to know this was happening, right? The interviews with the players fighting cancer years ago said the same thing. We have self-efficacy, we believe we can do something that matters, and we're adhering to our chemotherapy regimen better than people who didn't play the game because we have learned to take this active role. But now we can at least see the brain science actually matches up with this subjective, qualitative, intuitive understanding of games. I just think it's really extraordinary. I like to think of what this is showing us is that we can move away from the sense of like the pursuit of happiness to more the happiness of pursuit. That the games give us this ability to go after something that we want, and that what really lights us up is that process of pursuit, that process of challenging ourselves, and the outcome is not the thing that is lighting us up and activating us. It's just that happiness of being wholeheartedly engaged with something that's difficult for us. So I call gamers super empowered, hopeful individuals, and now I just think this is cool. Like, we can actually see what the brain of a super empowered, hopeful individual looks like. Now, there was one tweet that came up over the weekend in response to my little pre-keynote on Twitter that I just adored. It really resonated with me. David Solon, someone who's played many of my games, actually one of the best gamers in the world. If you make a game, try to get this guy to play it because he's like the best gamer. Nordic Ninja on Twitter. He said, games can change your life, mind, outlook, intelligence, self-image, health, so pretty much your destiny. Games can change your destiny. Now that's something meaty that I want to chew on because, you know, we've already convinced people that games can change the world, and that sounded crazy like 5 years ago. I'm ready for the next level of crazy, which is that games can change your destiny. This is a comic done by a woman named Leah. She does Dharma comics, called. And when I think about destiny, I think this is really a good way to think about it. I'm sure everybody can see it. So kids, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? Asks, you know, the alley teacher. And you know, the tadpole's got a pretty good idea of what he wants to grow up to be. He wants to grow up to be a frog. And the acorn maybe wants to grow up to be a mighty oak. And the caterpillar has the destiny to grow up to be a butterfly. But the kid doesn't know. And I like this one. Actually, the first time I saw this, I actually cried. I don't know if I was being highly emotional at the time. But does the tadpole know it's growing up to be a frog? Does it know that it has a bigger, better version of itself? Does it know that? And then it's not worried. In the way that so many of us worry, are we growing up to be the biggest, best version of ourselves? And we don't even know what that blueprint is and what we should be trying to grow up to be. But that nature knows that maybe we have a nature inside us that will be that bigger, better version if we can just figure out what it is. Now, We know also from research that the kids are spending 10,000 hours of gaming by the age of 21, and I'm wondering if, like that, you know, acorn growing up to be a mighty oak, if gaming is kind of changing that hardwired destiny for us. You know, I wonder what seed have we planted in people growing up playing games. We usually think of games as not being real, but I wanted to do a little geeky entomology with you guys. You know, because games are virtual, so they can't possibly change anything. They're the opposite of reality. But if you look at the roots of the word virtual, it comes from the Latin, modern Latin, virtualis, which comes from older Latin, virtus, which means excellence, potency, efficacy, the meaning of being something in essence, probably via sense of being capable of producing a certain effect. So the idea that the virtual means that it has the power or the potential to be something. You know, as another person says, entomologically, virtual means full of virtue. Virtue being taken here as the capacity to act. It could be thought of as a domain of latency or possibility, that the virtual is just kind of lying there, waiting to be realized. So when you think about it that way, the opposite of virtual isn't real, right? The opposite of virtual is actualized, taking that seed and making it real. There's this great philosopher, Pierre Levy, who I studied a lot when I was doing my PhD, and he said, within the seed lies the possibility of a tree, a virtual tree that has not yet been actualized. And I'm wondering if games are changing our seed, are implanting a different seed, a different destiny for us. And this is going to sound a little bit out there, but I found this picture taken in June 2009 of me fighting a ninja rabbit. By the way, if you haven't seen ninja rabbits before, they are hardcore, and you really got to fight them, because those ears wrap up around its face like a ninja mask. So check that out, ninja rabbit. And this is a screenshot from the Buffy the Vampire video game. Now, this was June 2009. I hit my head in July 2009. And I found this picture and I thought, God, you know, like something had been implanted by Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And I was already, I already had that seed, that possible destiny in me before I hit my head and before I wanted to die and before I became Jane the Concussion Slayer. And maybe it wasn't Super Better, the game that saved my life. Maybe it was the 30, you know, plus years of life that I'd spent gaming that had planted that seed in me, that I would have self-efficacy, that I would be able to rise to the heroic occasion in real life. It's a weird idea, I'm still playing with it. But you know, we have like a billion gamers on the planet, so people spending an average of an hour a day playing games. And maybe if we're lucky, all of these gamers are gonna grow up to have this different destiny, this destiny of self-efficacy, this destiny of being able to change their own lives. And we can help them do that by making games that tap into that ability. Let's go. This is what's on my mind a lot. If you want to find other comics like this, I just encourage you. It's called Dharma Comics, D-H-A-R-M-A. Click. So now, you know, Jane the Concussion Slayer has become Super Better. It's a mobile app. It's a web online. We launched the beta 12 weeks ago, and we have 35,000 registered players now using the game to get Super Better a lot of things. And I just wanted to share with you a little bit of the feedback that we're getting, sort of explore this idea that we're building up these different types of resilience and helping players change lives. By the way, all the science that I'm geeking out about, on our advisors and partners include the UC Berkeley Greater Good Science Center, Stanford University School of Medicine, and their CARE program, which stands for the Center for Compassion and Altruism Research and Education. It's a great program. University of Pennsylvania's Positive Psychology Center, and Ohio State University Medical Research Center. And so I'm very grateful to them for all of the wisdom that they're putting into our game design. And I encourage all game designers to work with scientists. So, you know, here we are, we're activating power-ups in the game now, the same thing that boosted my positive emotions. And we hear from players things like, you know, what's really working for me is going to Super Better when I felt like I needed help, finding things to do, new power-ups and doing them. Even if it didn't change anything, it made me feel like I was actually doing something about it. It took away that sense of powerlessness. And so I think we can see there where the self-efficacy and that belief that we can change our destiny comes into play. We've got people battling bad guys now. You do these battle reports. Let us know if you won or lost. We, you know, give you your resilience score increase on that. And here's what some players are telling us about bad guys. For the first time, I was able to have an evening where I was very depressed, but able to know that it would get better. Able to get out of the all or nothing thinking. Just because you lost to a bad guy today, you could win against it tomorrow. And that's really interesting, that sense of mental resilience, right? The ability to fail and come back and stay determined. I want to show you a video of some people playing. Maybe we can pause it, and then we'll get some volume on it. My friends backstage are going to help. They're going to rewind this and start over, and then we're going to hear it, possibly.
I heard the Super Project in order that I could.
So that's video from like where, and that audio. They're having.
Maintain my levels. The actives and not really thinking about.
Backstage team, we're hearing audio from the end of the video, and we're not seeing the video, in case you're wondering.
Creative
Well, why don't we stop the video you're playing, and we'll just keep going. Maybe I'll point you to the videos online, and that'll be okay too. Let's see if we got some slides. Okay, we'll stop there. So this is the person whose voice you were actually hearing. He's really interesting. His name is Philip Jeffrey. He has a terminal diagnosis of cancer, and he has stopped cancer treatment. He's exhausted his options, and he decided to start playing Super Better. And in Super Better, you have an epic win, sort of something you're not sure is possible, but you're going to go for it anyway. In the video, you also have seen somebody whose epic win was to lose 10 pounds, and he did it. Another woman, her epic win was to sleep for 4 hours a night, every night for a week, because she has chronic pain that leads to insomnia. And she never slept more than 3 hours a night in years, and that only happened twice a year. And she got that epic win. She slept 4 hours a night for 7 days in a row. Philip decided, because he's not getting treatment anymore, he decided to play, his epic win would be to take a photo, a creative self-portrait of himself every day for 90 days. And he did this because he wanted to have a reason to get out of bed every day. He talks in the video about how sometimes when you're fighting cancer, you just don't want to get out of bed, and you don't. And he felt like he'd sort of withdrawn from the world. So this was going to get him out into the world, and it would help him end every day on a positive note, because he would shoot the photography during the magic hour, which is where the light's really beautiful in the sky. And he would do the self-portrait, and he would upload it at the end of the night. This was a photo that he uploaded last week that he was really excited about, and I'm really excited about. That's his current cancer level. Now, it's really high. Normal is zero. But he was excited because the last time he checked his cancer level, it had been 40.1. And he felt really good about knowing that he was at 35.9, because when you stop cancer treatment, you assume that it's just going to get worse and worse. Now, obviously, Super Better did not lower his cancer from 40.1 to 35.9, right? That's not how the game works. It's not working at that level. But what did happen that I think is really interesting is I think we can say for sure that without Super Better, Philip would not have known that his cancer level was 35.9, because he had disengaged. He was not actively engaged with his health in the same way. And he might not have gone to that doctor, and he might not have gotten that good news. And so what I think we're seeing is that Super Better is helping players engage wholeheartedly with these challenges, and in a way that maybe would not be possible without the emotional resilience, the mental resilience, the social resilience that we get from games. We had a player named Michael who's playing for depression, who just last week won a half marathon. He came in first place of all the men. Now, obviously, you don't win a half marathon because you played Super Better, but he told us that he wouldn't have entered the race. He wouldn't have, even after he paid for the race fee, he's not even sure he would have shown up to run the race, because when you battle depression, you don't always follow through. But he credits Super Better and the community around Super Better for helping him actually show up. So we can't take credit for winning the race, but we take credit for him showing up just to run. The other thing that's really important about Super Better are the allies who play with you. We help you recruit allies from Facebook and Twitter and from our own community. We encourage you to play with at least one person you know in real life. And here's what some people say about allies. You know, Super Better added a level of accountability I haven't had before. I'm accountable to my allies now, because you tell them what's going on and what you're going to do and the quest you're going to take. Other players said, you know, we talk in super better ease. That could have been an epic win. You should add that as a power-up. It's become integrated into our vocabulary. Someone else said we can talk about stuff more because now I have words to put to, the rest of the quote is, to put to the goals that my brother has. So that we can understand each other better and understand the lives that we're trying to lead or the dreams we're trying to achieve. And that the game builds our social resilience in that way. So it kind of leaves us with this question of, you know, I wish I'd led a life true to my dreams and not what others expected of me. Are games doing this yet? I'm not sure, but I know that as a game designer, this is what I'm really interested in. I believe that all games can play a role in helping us lead a life true to our dreams, which is why I shared with you all of that research at the beginning about games, all games boosting our family relationships or helping us stay in contact with friends and family. We're gonna skip past these because I'm not feeling. Well, does this work? Try see how this works.
I love it. And I thought, how am I gonna make the most of the rest of my life? I married
yeah, I don't think that's really
about 2.5 years ago.
Why don't we just skip ahead?
Anything that I want.
We'll say farewell to the videos. See you again another time. We're just gonna come on, let's keep going. Keep going. All right. I'm committed to also making games that help people bring their gamer strengths to real life. And I think about it sort of in two ways. You know, some of us have to survive this trip. Some of us will face very difficult things in our lives. And we can use games to help us survive that trip to the underworld. And other people, you know, they're not going to have to go to the underworld, but maybe they're just going to choose their own adventure, right? This is the post-ecstatic growth. Goals that they have, dreams that they want to see fulfilled, writing a book, learning a foreign language, and that we can bring games to people's lives to help them focus the time and attention and get the social support they need and the mental resilience to not be scared and not give up and keep trying. So that's kind of my premise, that games can change lives, and games can change our destiny by changing us at the neurological level, by changing us at almost the spiritual level and in what we think that we're capable of achieving, and that we can measure that change. All the science that I shared with you, I think, are ways that we're beginning to measure things like positive emotions and mental resilience and self-efficacy and social support. We can measure that change. Now, speaking of measuring change, I did promise to increase the lifespan of everyone in the room by 7.5 minutes, so I want to just let you know exactly how I measured that today. Now, it turns out that people who regularly boost these four kinds of strengths, the physical resilience, the mental resilience, emotional resilience, and social resilience, live 10 years longer than everybody else. There are literally more than 1,000 peer-reviewed scientific studies that you can look at that I link to the meta-studies of online that show that this is true. If you are regularly achieving the 3-to-1 positive emotion ratio, if you are regularly doing things that make you happy, if you are connecting with friends and family members, contacting one person every single day that you care about, if you are not sitting still for more than an hour at a time, so always make sure you're doing something every hour, and if you're tackling tiny goals every day to boost your willpower, you will live 10 years longer than everybody else, which is where that math that I showed you earlier comes in. So we know that the average life expectancy in the US and UK is 78.1 years. We know that you can boost that life expectancy by 10 years over the course of your whole life by boosting your four types of resilience, which means that each year that you're boosting your resilience will give you on average 0.12804097 more years of life, or 46 more days of life, or 67,298 more minutes of life, which means every single day that you are boosting your resilience, you're actually getting 184 more minutes of life, and every hour that you're boosting your resilience, just like we did for the past hour together, you're actually getting 7.682458837 more minutes of life. So that circle is in the wrong place. A PC previous station. Yes. But you're getting 7.6 minutes of life. So I'm just like, that is all yours. You are mid, so congratulations. That's the good news. Now, bonus mission here. How will you spend your extra 7.5 minutes? And I told you I had an idea for you. So here's my suggestion. These 7.5 minutes are kind of like genie's wishes. You know that old trick? You use your first wish to wish for a million more wishes. So if you spend your 7.5 minutes today doing something that makes you happy or gets you physically active or connects you with a loved one or helps you focus on a goal that really matters to you, you'll actually be building up your resilience, so you will earn more minutes. And the good news is you can actually go on like this hour after after hour, day after day, for the rest of your life, earning another 7.5 minutes of extra life every hour, all the way to your deathbed, which will now be 10 years later, on average, than it would have been otherwise. And when you get there, more likely than not, you won't have any regrets, because you will have spent your life building up the four kinds of strength that it takes to live a life truer to your dreams. Even if you spent a lot of time playing games, and maybe because you spent a lot of time playing games. So, thank you very much.